Hope you guys had a good lunch and lots of coffee as well. It's always interesting going right after lunch, right? So I'm going to quiz you guys at the end of my presentation. So anyway, so, you know, thank you for inviting us, and Meredith especially, you know, did a phenomenal job of coordinating, so this is a really great turnout as well. So my name is Dinesh Vandaya. I lead the industry advisory group for life sciences and healthcare for SAP. Been with SAP for about 8 years. So the last 3 years of my career at SAP, I've focused really on the front end of life sciences and healthcare. And what I mean by that is mostly, if you think about pharma, you know, mostly research and development and health economics outcomes research or commercial side of the house. And in terms of providers, you know, more on the clinical side of the house. Am I doing something wrong here? It's echoing.
It's back up a little bit.
It seems to be worse.
Okay. Is this better? Yeah. Okay. So before taking on this role, I was basically responsible for go-to-market for our SAP HANA, which is our in-memory platform. Would be really disappointed if you know SAP and if you didn't know HANA, because we've done a good job of marketing it, I think. But even within that, my role was very specific to positioning HANA as an innovation platform. So how many of you are familiar with sort of the Gartner base layer strategy? If you think, yeah, so Peter would know that. Basically, there's three buckets, right? You've got the systems of record, and then the systems of engagement, and the systems of innovation. Most of our customers actually put SAP, obviously, in the systems of record. You know, we run a lot of the transaction systems for most of the companies in the world. And a lot of them actually put us in the systems of engagement because we do have a large analytics practice as well. Very few of the companies, even really companies that have supported SAP for a long time, put us in the innovation bucket. So my job was to really convince them to use the HANA platform as an innovation platform. So I would go to some of the biggest companies in the world, Dow's and ExxonMobil's and Shell's and Pfizer's of the world, the Walmart's of the world, and basically say, give me the biggest, baddest problems that you have and we can solve it for you. So that's what I did for about 5 years. It was pretty cool. You know, we would actually create some of these decks that were almost provocative. Like we went to Kraft and said, we can save $250 million in inventory for you. You know, are you interested in listening to us? That's sort of, and we did that, right? I mean, so a lot of the cases we did some very, very interesting scenarios where we positioned HANA as a innovation platform. And for most of the rest of my career, I deployed SAP. You know, basically I would, you know, be part of several large transformation projects, mostly around the area. So I worked at, you know, IBM, putting in their procurement system at Endicott. I worked at Pfizer, Wyatt, Bristol Myers, Johnson & Johnson. I heard something from JJ. So I was part of the global supply chain group in Bridgewater. Actually worked at Air Products as well for about 3 years. I'm not sure who's from Air Products here, but I worked. So I was part of the Air Products SAP implementation team for about 3 years, at DuPont for a very long time as well. So I've got a lot of industry experience the last 3 or 4 years really focused on the front end of pharma and health sciences. So a little bit about SAP. I guess some of the numbers are not coming up here. I'm not sure what happened. But you know, so we're about a 47-year-old company now. You know, we have about 80,000 employees. We're headquartered in Waldorf, Germany. But the North American headquarters for SAP is right around the corner in Newtown Square. Obviously, our heritage is, you know, building enterprise applications. We started with ERP. You know, when we first started, probably in the early 1970s, we were probably one of the first companies to actually integrate all functions within an enterprise into one system. So whether it's, you know, financial or controlling or sales and distribution, materials management, procurement, all of them in one system, right? So this is, you know, kind of, you know, if you look at, you know, our strength, that's where we started. But obviously, we branched on to a lot of other things. I was telling somebody that our cloud business, I mean, we're in the midst of transitioning to the cloud, and recently we had about 2016, I think we had over 2 billion euros in revenues in the cloud. So our focus is changing as well. Our customers are demanding to go more to the cloud from on-premise, so that's where we're going as well. And as you said, I mean, you know, there's some numbers there. I mean, we serve almost 3,800 life science companies in 87 countries. We have close to about 8,000 healthcare providers in 94 different countries. So we have, you know, fairly good footprint in a lot of these markets, especially outside of the United States. For healthcare providers, we actually provide a EMR system in collaboration with Siemens and now with Cerner. So if you go to a country like Singapore, 98% of the hospitals in Singapore actually run SAP ISH Med. It's a EMR solution that we provide in collaboration with Cerner. So I'm going to basically divide my talk into three topics, right? What is a technology company like SAP doing in this space, especially improving patient outcomes and reducing costs? What is the role for a company like SAP? And I'm going to discuss some of the trends that we're seeing in the marketplace. Number two is I'm going to briefly talk a little bit about HANA. Somebody's going to shoot me at SAP. So I got to talk a little bit about HANA, very briefly, what's the advantage and what's the architecture. And number three, I'm going to spend a little bit of time talking about use cases or case studies that our customers are using, using our technology. Right? And then most of the use cases that I'm talking about are more focused on patient outcomes, right? Not the business side of it, not the supply chain or not the financial side of it. Obviously, we have tons and tons of use cases, but more focused on the improvement of patient outcomes and what are some of those use cases and studies, right? So I'll talk about three trends, right? One is the cost pressure. So, I mean, people have heard these numbers, but it's still mind-boggling, right? So we, in the US, spend almost 18% of our GDP on healthcare, right? And most of the Western nations, the average is about 13 to 18% of GDP in healthcare. And the situation is actually getting worse, right? Most Western populations are getting older, obviously more diseases, and the current model is basically unsustainable. If something doesn't change, we're going to face a lot of problems, right? And the irony, in my mind, is really having worked in a lot of different industries, 10 different industries, the irony is really we're throwing a lot of money, we're not getting the outcomes that we deserve, right? So I'll give you one KPI, and I pulled this directly from the CDC website, and it's probably almost 4 years old, and it relates to medication adherence, right? So 30% of the prescriptions are never filled, right? Even when they're filled, 50% of the time, they've never actually followed through, especially for chronic diseases like diabetes or cardiovascular disease. Most people stop taking the prescriptions, right? And it costs, the U.S. healthcare system is about $300 billion. 125,000 deaths annually as a result of non-adherence. So you look at these numbers, it's mind-boggling. No other industry has put up with these kind of things. Right? When you throw money at a problem, at least you get some results. The only place that I've seen is healthcare where we're throwing a lot of money, we're not getting the results we deserve. I mean, some of the numbers, I don't know if you noticed, there was a research paper in Nature magazine, and this also was about 4 or 5 years ago, where they had actually talked about the efficacy of the top 10 grossing drugs in the United States. And the best efficacy was 1 in 4. And the worst was 1 in 50. 1 in 50, and these are the top 10 grossing drugs. Right, so the cost pressures are there. There's got something's going to break, it's at a point where we have to do something. And as most other industries have done, I think technology is probably going to save healthcare as well. Right, the second trend that we're seeing is I kind of put it in a technology bucket, but I'm going to break it down into smaller chunks. Right, I mean I think Venkat asked a question about precision medicine and how soon. The trend that we're seeing is, obviously, genomic sequencing, the cost of sequencing is going down, right? So that's, we partner with Dr. Bustamante at Stanford Medical School, and he puts a nice chart where he shows a Ferrari, and if you bought the Ferrari about, 10 years ago, it would cost him about $300,000, and if you applied the same factors of reduction in genome sequencing, that same Ferrari would cost him 11 cents, right? So we're basically pushing down the curve. I mean, it's Moore's law, right? I mean, every 18 months, the performance is going to improve and the cost is going to go down, right? So we're approaching that. I mean, so that to me, I think is a very positive trend. So the other trend we're seeing is, companion diagnostics. And I mean, this is a business school, so maybe I'll give you a case study as well. It's very recent, right? So immunotherapy is sort of a new treatment in terms of cancer. And please correct me if I say something wrong. So, if you look at most of the drugs in the market, they're kind of, around, you know, two or three different targets. The first target, I mean, the most popular target is called program dead one, PD-1, or PD-L1, which is the corresponding antigen. So a lot of the drugs that are available in the market are sort of targeting those targets, right? So Bristol Myers was one of the first to actually bring a drug to market called Opdivo. And their strategy initially was, you know, the clinical trials, the patient cohorts that they selected, they didn't do this sort of companion diagnostic. They had a much broader population. And as a second line therapy for lung cancer, they didn't get an approval from FDA. So initially, they didn't require a companion diagnostic. Compared it to Merck, and their first foray into this is called Keytruda, which is a trade name for their immunotherapy drug. But they actually, you know, sort of chose the patient cohorts based on a certain biomarker being present, in this case, PD-L1. If you have the biomarker, then those are the patients that they were recruiting into the clinical trial. So even though they met the endpoint, the market sort of decided the oncologists were kind of prescribing Opdivo more because it didn't require a companion diagnostic. And so, you know, Bristol Myers was selling 2016, I think almost $2 billion of Opdivo versus Merck with Keytruda was around $500 to $600 million. But last fall, what happened was, as a first line therapy for non-small cell lung cancer, they went with the same patient cohort strategy for clinical trial design, and Bristol Myers Opdivo did not meet the endpoint for non-small cell lung cancer as a first-line therapy. As a result, the market whacked it. They lost about $25 to $30 million in market cap, right? Keytruda actually met the endpoint, and their market cap went up by $15 billion. So there are certainly market trends that are going to push, you know, molecular level diagnostics or companion diagnostics to be a necessity. And we're just getting started, right? And we spoke to a professor at the University of Southern California. His name is Dr. Agus. And he's basically saying proteomics is the next in line. I mean, we can actually use proteomics to actually even, you know, be more precise in diagnosis. And the problem is that, you know, to study one reaction time in one human reaction time, one time series, could generate about hundreds of thousands of columns of wide of data, right, width of data. So it may not be big data, but it's really, really, really wide data. Right? Think about it, I mean, just one patient, one time series, one body reaction that you're studying. So obviously there's, you know, this is, you know, it's, you know, as the cost goes down, these kinds of molecular diagnostics, companion diagnostics, are going to become more and more commonplace. Right now, they're probably used in mostly academic medical centers at a research level, but it's not really common, right? So that's one trend. The second trend is, I mean, I think somebody spoke about Internet of Things, right? I mean, this is not just wearables like Fitbit. I mean, there are lots of biometric sensors that are increasingly getting popular. There's actually a drug for Alzheimer's that has a pill. That has a sensor in the pill. So when you take the drug, it actually sends a timestamp to your smartphone saying that you've indeed taken the drug. Right? So there's going to be a lot of biosensors. I was at HIMSS, not this year, the year before. They had a whole sort of area for connected health. And one of the things that I saw was, you know, for people that are suffering from Alzheimer's, they have sensors in the body because the cost of care when they're at home is a lot cheaper and actually better than when they're actually in a hospital, right? So if I can use sensors to actually monitor, you know, what they're doing, how they're doing, including, you know, after 9 p.m., if they take off and go outside the property, they know something's wrong, right? You can actually start tracking at that level. So there should be a lot of sensor data. And this is, again, Moore's law, right? As the cost of sensors go down, people are going to find, you know, more and more usage for it. I mean, you know, think about in the 70s, if somebody told you your hair dryer is going to have, you know, 10 microprocessors, nobody would have believed it, right? So it's the same kind of concept. In 10, 15 years, we're going to have biosensors for, you know, pretty much every disease. And even from a healthy perspective, you're going to have a lot of biosensors. So that's, you know, to me, sort of the technology bucket. Third bucket is really patient empowerment. I mean, this is one of the most powerful things, right? I mean, we met with the head of Facebook healthcare, and he told us that there are, just in the U.S., about 300,000 focus groups just for cancer. 300,000 focus groups just for cancer, where people just go in and say, hey, I'm taking this drug, I'm not feeling well, you know, what can I do? And other people sort of jump in that have the same condition, sort of, you know, have a conversation, in some cases even doctors have been. And what they found is they actually are more open in a social media forum than actually what they tell their oncologist. And you know, so this is, you know, really sort of a very powerful concept, right? There are actually companies that are mining data. You know, there's one Israeli company that I know that actually scours the internet, and they basically are building a real-world evidence platform based on patient experience. There's so much data out there, and they've done this by therapeutic class, disease state, therapeutic class, and by drug. Right, so there's so much metadata. And actually, there's, you know, some examples where they're actually changing the laws in Texas on, because people are, you know, basically, you know, demanding that they be put on immunotherapy drugs and not on chemotherapy, knowing how effective immunotherapy is. So there's, you know, patient empowerment is actually a very, very important aspect of this. Right? So at the end of the day, the point that I'm making is all of this is not possible without having a, you know, a sort of a digital strategy, a digital platform to handle this massive amounts of data. And the reason I say that, I mean, there's other industries that have gone down this digitization curve, right? So for example, if you think about John Deere, I mean, you think about John Deere as a stodgy old company. But you know, one of the things that they did was, they came to SAP and said, you know, basically, we want to have, you know, a predictive maintenance platform, you know, for the big harvester machines, you know, they have those big lean machines. And these machines are so crucial to harvest time, especially because they're expensive, they cost, you know, upwards of $1 million. So a lot of the smaller farmers, you know, they actually pool money to buy, you know, one of these machines. And each of them gets sort of a timeshare at the time of harvest, right? So they might get 3 or 4 days to harvest their field, and then it goes on to the next farmer. But if the machine fails, I mean, the whole harvest is gone, right? So what they would do, you know, they were basically putting sensors in these harvesters, so we can collect all the data. And you know, SAP, you know, basically did all of the algorithms for predictive maintenance, and basically, you know, fix the problem before the problem occurs. I don't know if you've seen the commercial with John Deere, where there's a, it was a FedEx or UPS guy delivering a part to a farmer, and the farmer says, "I didn't order it," but you know, the guy says, "But your machine ordered it," right? So we're, I mean, so the key part of that is, I mean, it's not just, you know, predictive maintenance, right? What Deere has done with the data, because they're putting sensors in it, because they're collecting a lot of data, you know, at the time of harvest, at the time of sowing, in terms of what the soil moisture, soil temperature, humidity, all of those conditions are, they can actually do some computations to tell the farmer, you know, how to improve the yield. I mean, to a farmer, what's more important than improving yield, right? So you think about it, I mean, so they've kind of gone down the digitization curve, which is what we're hoping that, you know, we can do for healthcare, right? So that's kind of the genesis of why, you know, what a technology company is, well, not just SAP, again, IBM, Microsoft, everybody's sort of pursuing the same sort of strategy, right? And we believe that if we don't do that, I mean, you know, we're not going to be able to improve the patient outcomes at a cost that's sustainable for society in general, right? Okay, so what is our strategy? I mean, I'm going to spend a little bit of time, right? So, we are actually late to the game in terms of, you know, sort of the front end of pharma or healthcare, right? So there've been a lot of companies that have, you know, sort of established the beachhead in those areas. So our strategy is really very bold, right? We want to build a marketplace, if you will, a health marketplace, where a lot of the entities can actually, you know, trade their data and services. And what I mean by that is, if you look at the entire medical value chain, right, whether it's academic medical centers or, you know, pharma companies, you know, payers, providers, even government entities that support public health, there's really literally no exchange of information between any of these parties. It has a direct impact on patient, you know, outcomes and medical research and patient outcomes for sure. Right. When you talk to pharma companies, you talk to a lot of pharma companies, you know, they actually, even their own clinical trials data across the same disease state is not fully integrated. Right? I mean, they remain in data silos. Forget, you know, connecting data sets across disease states, right? And there's, you know, huge demand for those kinds of connections as well, right? I go any further back, I'm going to hit the wall. But, you know, there was actually a report probably 3 years ago for a class of drugs called anthracyclines. You might know that. And it was used to treat leukemia in children, right? And basically, it was very successful in treating leukemia in children. But what it did was, over time, it actually damaged, you know, heart tissue. So a lot of these kids that, you know, beat cancer are actually dying of heart disease in their late teens and early 20s. So what good is it? I mean, if we, you know, you treat one disease and you're causing another disease, right? So there is actually a business reason as well, I mean, a health reason, an outcome reason to connect a lot of these data sets. So our strategy is not only to help, you know, a cloud-based platform to help, you know, these kinds of entities not only to integrate their data sets within within a single entity, but also provide this marketplace where they can actually trade the data and services, right? If it's a research organization and two research organizations wants to collaborate and there's no monetization, that's fine. But we believe there's, you know, lots of interesting data sets. I mean, I talked to one of the researchers at Bayer, and he basically said, you know, I was just looking for a patient cohort with a specific biomarker that I want to, I just want to do a quick digital analysis on whether my hypothesis would be is right or not. But for him to do that today, it takes anywhere from, you know, several weeks to almost 6 to 7 months, you know, first to get the contract done and then getting the data from whoever is selling the data and basically, you know, figuring out how to load it in the IT systems and then doing his analysis takes anywhere from 6 to 8 months. That's what he told us. So VSB can actually help, you know, actually provide this marketplace where you can actually go in and log in and search for this kind of content, where there's indexed content, and we can facilitate the transfer of that data, then I think, you know, there's going to be a huge value in it. And we know this because we probably operate one of the largest business networks in the world. You know, there's about close to $1 trillion worth of transactions that pass through the VSB business network. Actually, if you think about it, it's bigger than Amazon, eBay, Alibaba, all put together, right? It's huge, massive. So we know how to put these kinds of systems together. That's what we're shooting for. It's a big vision. I think technology-wise, I think we're fairly confident we can solve it. It's the rest of the politics is going to be fairly challenging. I think the business model probably is going to be more challenging than the technology.
Is that place on the right, is that in China or something, the third place in China?
No, I mean, this is just sort of a representative, you know, diagram. It's basically...
Because you got one in Philly, looks like almost one, yeah. In Germany almost.
Yeah, we got to have one in Philly and Germany because, you know, it's kind of our big centers. But it's just a representative diagram.
Sure. Yeah.
So a little bit about HANA, right? So I talked a little bit about HANA. So what is it that we have done, especially from a health perspective? It's HANA is an in-memory platform. Maybe I take a brief second and talk about really the five, I call it principles of HANA, right? I mean, why HANA, right? So one, I think it's all in memory. So there's no caching, there's no, you know, none of those things. And the only time that the data is actually stored in disks is only for the purposes of disaster recovery. Otherwise, all of the data is stored in memory for any kind of processing, okay? Number two, so I think Patrick actually mentioned about columnar store. All of the data is actually stored in a columnar store. Why is it important, right? One, you get natural compression. And what I mean by that is you know, even in our own case, I think we had our enterprise data, even though we're a large company, we don't do manufacturing, so we don't have a lot of data. It's mostly financial and sales data. Our ERP system was about 8 terabytes, right? It was finely tuned, highly compressed DB2 system. You couldn't design it any better. It was still 8 terabytes. When we actually went to HANA, our total data sizes went down to about 400 gigabytes. Right? So it's incredible compression. And when you start thinking about the kinds of, you know, data that we're going to get, you know, as we're getting, as we start using more sensors, we start using more molecular diagnostics, as we start using more of the environmental data, at some point, you're going to get to a big data stage, right? We're actually approaching that for one of our customers, ASCO and Castellan, right? So it's incredibly important to have, you know, that sort of compression capabilities. And more importantly, I think for us, you know, the secret sauce for SAP in terms of HANA is that usually, when you think about system design, for analytics, people use columnar store for analytics because it's easy to retrieve data. But a columnar store for writing data is very hard because if you have a transaction system, you're creating sales orders or process orders or purchase orders, that's actually creating a transaction record. For that, the system design was always a row-based store. So our secret sauce is we've figured out how to use a columnar store to do both analytics and writing a transaction. Obviously, we need to do that, right? So that's important for us. The third one, I think, is the most important one, which is all of the planning engines in HANA, right? All of the computation engines, all of the predictive engines, you know, natural language processing engine, all of these engines actually reside in memory. And why is it important? Because then I can store the data fundamentally at an atomic level in HANA once and don't have to move the data around to do different calculations. If I want to do predictive calculations, I can do it right there without actually physically having to move the data. If I want to do geospatial analysis, I can do it without physically having to move the data. Right? And this was important for us, I mean, not just from a healthcare perspective, but also from a general technology perspective, because our code base for our core ERP systems got incredibly complex. We have about 500 million lines of code, right? And with that, you know, there's a lot of complexities. I think Patrick showed the indexes and aggregates and all of these things that have to be built into the code just to have a respectable level of performance. And when we did a survey, our founder, actually, Hasso Plattner, basically did a survey on why a lot of our customers are not in using the most recent innovation from SAP. The number one answer for them was the complexity of the system. Because it was a core system to their business, it was sitting in the center, and any sort of upgrade, they have to do regression testing. It's not just the SAP system that they're testing, but they're also testing all of the different systems that SAP touches, all of the different integration points. And in some cases, a regression test could actually take 6 to 8 months to complete. And at the end of the day, you know, there's very little business value in justifying a regression test, right? So we had to fundamentally rethink how we architect our systems. And we, our belief was the underlying deficiencies of the relational database was the core issue. So that's why we actually, the main reason why we invented HANA was to really sort of solve that problem. So that's very important for us, and that's the third principle. The fourth principle, I just want to quickly go through, Patrick touched on it as well, is the massive parallel processing capability. And we worked with Intel very closely at a chip level to actually have this MPP capabilities, because it's fairly new in terms of how you do this in memory, right? And the last one is really not, you know, SAP's innovation, but we're kind of riding a trend. You know, you're able to now store more and more. I mean, you're able to squeeze in more and more cores into a chip, and you're able to squeeze in more and more memory into a chip, and the cost of memory is going down, right? So we're kind of riding that train. So to me, I think that's the core value prop for HANA. And what we've done from a health perspective and a life sciences perspective is we've taken this core platform, which is in gray, and we've built very specific things that are related to the health sciences, right? For example, if you think about natural language processing, I think John spoke about this. It's a native engine that comes out of HANA, but it doesn't have the medical ontologies on top of that. So we built the medical ontologies on top of that. We have a team in Boston that all they do is build medical ontologies on top of the NLP engine for HANA, right? So we've kind of created some of the models here, the clinical data model, the genomic data model, all of the workflow, the security, user management, master patient index, all of the things that are related to healthcare sits on top of that HANA platform. So we take advantage of all of the core capabilities of HANA, and we actually put a spin, a healthcare spin on top of that. Right? That's what the platform is about. And this is, I think Peter left. I mean, we're using, the first versions of this platform is gonna sit on Amazon Web Services, but we have partnerships with Microsoft. We have partnerships, I think recently we announced Google Cloud as also a hosting partner. And our strategy is to build everything in containers, so we're not, beholden to any single cloud provider. And it's in the benefit of our customers as well, because then they will not be, the right word is not blackmail in terms of asking for more. If you're beholden to one, there's no reason why they can't keep increasing the prices. So our strategy is to build them in containers so our customers will have the flexibility to move the software to any sort of cloud provider that they choose to. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the use cases itself, some customer case studies. Any questions on this so far? You guys are all awake. Go ahead.
What's HANA stand for? Sorry.
Well, it's it's a very tricky question. I think the actual name is High Performance Analytic Appliance, but it's not an appliance anymore. It's but also I think the code name is our founder's Hasso Plattner. We internally I think it was basically called Hasso's new architecture.
High performance
analytic appliance, but it's not an appliance anymore. I mean, when we first released it, it was an appliance, but now you can buy sort of, there are certain specifications that we provide in terms of what servers are best suited to run HANA, but it's not an appliance. Any other questions? Okay. So I'll talk a little bit about, case studies, right? So the first one that I'm going to talk about is really ASCO, which stands for the American Society of Clinical Oncology. They're, I think, the world's largest oncology organization. I think they have more than 45,000 members, and about 40% of their membership is actually outside of the United States, even though it's called the American Society of Clinical Oncology. And they're sort of, I wouldn't call it a trade organization, but they're basically the people that develop standards in care for cancer and so on. Their annual conference in Chicago is kind of the who's who in the cancer world, right? I mean, it's basically about 45,000-50,000 people land in Chicago at McCormick Place every June. And this is not just from not only from a scientific perspective, but it also has a huge business impact. I mean, a lot of business analysts attend this conference because it has a direct impact on stock price. So if you haven't been to one, I think it's really fascinating to go. I mean, it boggled my mind that the cancer ecosystem is that big. I mean, it's just humongous. And these people host it. So what is the purpose? What do they do? In this case, they have a subsidiary called CancerLink, which is a not-for-profit subsidiary of ASCO. And basically, their number one goal was to create a self-learning network, right? So if you look at it today, there's about 1.7 million cancer patients every year in the US alone. These are new cancer patients, every year, 1.7 million. And that number is actually getting bad. Dr. Huddis, who is the CEO of ASCO, actually presented, some research last year where, they have now reasons to believe that obesity, is linked to cancer. And we as a country have an obesity problem as well. So this number is going to go up, and we don't know globally what these numbers are, right? But the percentage of people that actually enroll in clinical trials are only 3%. Think about it, 1.7 million cancer patients, but only 3% of their population actually enrolls in clinical trials. And even more important is the type of people that enroll in clinical trials. I kind of, sort of say that, these are, like marathon runners who just happen to have cancer. They're generally healthier people that just happen to have cancer, right? So if you look at the numbers, vast majority, almost 61% of the real world patients are 65 or older, right? And they also have comorbidities. They don't only just suffer from cancer, they also have cardiovascular, diabetes, other complications, right? The other number is 40% of the kidney cancer patients are not even healthy enough to get on a clinical trial, right? And obviously the populations are not as diverse. I mean, it's mostly the people that are enrolling in clinical trials are usually white. And even within the white people, it's usually people that have access to get on clinical trials, generally more wealthier people that get on clinical trials. So it's not a very, it doesn't represent a broad spectrum of people that enroll in clinical trials, right? So that's kind of, the situation that exists today. So how do I actually, learn from the 97% of the population that do not enroll in clinical trials that are not actually representative of the general population, right? So that's the core idea behind the formation of CancerLink, right? So what they've done is basically they've signed on, I believe the numbers are close to over 100 practices. I mean, this includes, you know, from community hospitals to really large academic medical centers. And they extract the electronic medical data, the clinical data, and wherever genomic data is available, they extract the data. They put it into our platform. And there's two databases. One is a patient identifiable database that's only available for the respective clinician, right? And the second is an anonymized aggregated data set that will be available to the other members of the ASCO community. So what is the advantage of it? So if I'm, you know, an oncologist practicing in, let's say, North Dakota, and I'm presented with a very specific indication of cancer, and I've not seen the cancer before, you know, today, you know, whether we like it or not, you know, the treatment happens based on the gut feel of what the oncologist thinks. There's really no data-driven decision at this point in time. There's a slightly bigger practice, he or she may, you know, sort of consult with other oncologists in their practice and they collectively make a decision, right? This goes on, it's one of the things that, from a, you know, non-healthcare perspective, I was stunned that most of our healthcare is actually based on gut instinct and some practice, right? It's not really data-driven. So with this system, the same oncologist can actually log into this platform and simply query the system to see, have other, you know, oncologists been presented with this specific indication of cancer? And if so, what were the treatments that were offered? And what were the outcomes of those treatments? So there is a learning network that you create, right? So more and more data that goes into the system, the more and more robust it becomes, right? So right now they have about 2 million cancer patients in the platform. And their goal is to actually have close to about 3 million by June timeframe. At this point, frankly, the limitation is the technology. And this is where I think, you know, Patrick would attest to this. I mean, EMR data is actually very messy data, right? You know, how do we actually, you know, create a standardized, normalized database for the scale of, you know, the size of what, you know, ASCO and counseling want to do is not a trivial task, right? I mean, there's a lot of work that goes in. We're actually incorporating a lot of the machine learning algorithms to simply, you know, do the data normalization for that, right? This is a very crucial piece of technology because you can only throw so much people, after which it just becomes, there's no return on throwing more, you know, extra people at this job. So that's what we're doing. So basically, by June, they're going to have 3 million, and hopefully, you know, I think they already are probably the largest patient cohort for cancer in the entire world. In a short period of less than 18 months, they've accumulated, you know, this amount of patient database. And the advantage, I mean, not only based on, you know, from a treatment perspective, but also think about it. I mean, ASCO has what they call COPI measures, which is quality oncology program initiatives. It's basically KPIs and provides a care path and the best practice care path for treating certain types of cancer. And today, you know, that COPI measure is actually, you know, sort of done in a retrospective manner, right? Basically, if I'm an oncologist, I'm responsible for 100 patients, and, you know, my COPI measures are done maybe twice a year. And by the time it's done, that cancer patient may be out of my care already, right? But now it's, you know, it's done in real time. They can actually measure COPI measures or, you know, calculate COPI measures in real time and let the oncologist know, hey, look, you have, you know, maybe valid reasons for deviations from the standard, you know, care, but at least let them know that you're deviating from standard care. And this is going to be even more important because of the new MACRA MIPS laws and the oncology care model where providers are going to be penalized if they can't prove outcomes. I think it starts this year with plus or minus 4% where the penalties, you know, if you can't prove outcome is minus 4% for the CMS, based on the CMS rate card, and, you know, it's going to be plus 4% if you can actually prove outcomes, and it's going to go up to plus or minus 9% in 2020. So there is, you know, a lot of interest in getting these kinds of measures done. So that's, you know, the ASCO CancerLink use case. You know, obviously, you know, they're expanding, they're actually going global. Yeah.
So is this already in place?
It's live.
Second thing is, how do hospitals get access to this central repository? Yeah.
So basically, they have to contribute data, right? So they go talk to the providers. They basically, you know, the provider has to see value in this because you know, if they contribute data, they can actually get access to this larger database, so you create this learning network.
How do you handle privacy in this case?
Sorry?
How do you handle privacy in this case? Because it's a lot of patient data.
Yeah, absolutely, right? So I think this is you know, one of the bigger questions. I mean, this is why they have two databases. If you look at the architecture, there are two database structures. One is the patient identifiable data is only available to the caregiver, right? The second database is the anonymized aggregated. Even there, they have very strict rules. I mean, if they have genomic data and it's a very rare disease, and you know, obviously you can actually track to, you know, who the patient is, and in those cases, they cannot use the data as part of the system. Right? And some of those are automated, some of them are actually manually created. So it's a challenge. Any other questions? All right, so next use case that I want to talk about is really what we did with Roche Diagnostics. And I kind of put this use case in because this is getting very popular. It's called, you know, digital therapeutics, right? Basically, the use of technology along with a pill and some measuring device, right? In the case of Roche, I mean, they have a diabetes drug and they obviously have a diagnostics division that, you know, basically they provide a kit. It has a glucometer, it has, you know, wearables, it has some other things that measure blood sugar levels for the patients. So they basically onboard the patients using the provider network. Right? So they give this to the providers, so the providers onboard the patients. And the patient and the provider, the clinician, agree to what the appropriate levels are for them, blood sugar levels are. And, you know, they agree on a medication plan, they agree on a diet plan, they agree on, you know, exercise plan, and so on and so forth. And what SAP did was we created an application for both the iPhone and the Android platform, where basically the device data automatically gets captured through your smartphone and gets sent to a cloud where the computation's done. And if the patient is actually out of whack in terms of their blood sugar levels, it sends an alert to the patient and it sends an alert to the provider as well. So they can actually do medication adherence much better. And this is getting very popular. I mean, this is probably one of the most popular use cases in terms of digital therapeutic. I mean, we're working with a large hospital system in the US, which is mostly funded by the state, and they have a diabetes problem. They have about 300,000 diabetics in their state that are, you know, severely diabetic. And usually what happens is, you know, if they, you know, have illness due to diabetes, they actually go to emergency care in that state, in the hospital system, and the cost of emergency care is actually a lot more, right? So they want to have better outreach to these patients. And, you know, they're actually asking companies like SAP to work with pharma. So they want to bring pharma in because they don't have the funding to do these outreach programs. It's actually pretty expensive to do these outreach programs. So the holy trinity there is, you know, pharma comes to the table. So they fund these outreach programs, but they get real world evidence data in return. Right, so they can actually look at the data, and obviously anonymized aggregated data sets, but it helps them understand, you know, how their drugs are working in terms of, you know, what the specific indications were, and, you know, how can they actually improve the outcomes. Right, so this is becoming very popular. It's called digital therapeutic.
So I work in telehealth a lot. Mm-hmm. Have the physicians push back in the amount, the deluge of data that they are getting every time someone's blood sugar is too high or too low, which I'm sure occurs many times a day.
Yeah, actually, yeah. So, I mean, they have care coordination teams, so it's not the actual physician that gets the data. Okay. And this is where I think setting the alerts is also actually pretty important. The care coordination teams actually respond to that, right? So it's not usually the physicians, obviously. In certain examples, in the case of like transplant use cases, we're working with another large hospital system, and in their case, because the population is not always local, they're pretty well known, so a lot of the patient population is from outside of the local area, and outside of the country as well, and the problem for them is that, you know, if the patients leave their care, they go to very distant places, completely outside their purview. So how do I actually maintain, because transplant is, obviously pretty sensitive and it could be fatal if certain tests and certain things are not followed. And today they have giant care coordination teams that manually process these things and email and text and call? How do we automate some of these processes, you know, collect some of the reports and data in a more automated way? So that's part of the challenge as well. The other question, sorry.
No, it's not your focus, but is the monitor like implanted circuit?
No, so basically this one is not, right? But they're going, they're getting there. So this one is basically, you gotta still use a prick, yeah?
Okay.
But you know, they're developing the sensor, biometric sensor, that I think in the near future, I think I'm probably thinking the next 2-3 years, you will have those sensors that automatically send data, right? And there are actually, I mean, there are companies that are working on different technologies now where we can actually predict based on the amount of data that we, I mean, is a patient going to go hypoglycemic before the patient actually goes hypoglycemic, right? 3-4 hours before that happens. So think about the savings and most importantly, the outcome to the patient. Right. So this is another, NCT stands for the National Center for Tumor Diseases. How are we doing on time?
About 12 or 13
minutes. Okay, so I'll go quickly to some of these use cases as well. So National Center for Tumor Diseases is actually a collaboration. It's based in Heidelberg, Germany. It's a collaboration between the University of Heidelberg Hospital System and the German Cancer Research. Basically, they have two components, right? The research component, and actually they treat patients in that hospital as well. And one of the challenges that they had, and Patrick, you know, sort of articulated this very well this morning when we talked about it, is that they have, you know, so many data sets. I mean, imaging data sets, you know, clinical data sets, and you know, all of the publications and so on that they want to connect. And their goal was to simply identify a set of patients that meet a certain criteria to see whether they qualify for a certain clinical trial or not. They do run a lot of clinical trials at their premise. And it took them, Professor Mancala, who is the head of NCT, he actually presented at our conference. And you know, in a lot of cases, you know, it was so IT driven, and they would send data back and forth. It would take, you know, weeks to months to actually put these cohorts together. Obviously not very efficient. So they came to SAP. I mean, we're very close. I mean, our headquarters is literally 10 miles from Heidelberg. So we were a natural choice. So we built a very cool application. It's called Medical Research Insights. Obviously it was a long name because you know, the acronym for it stands for MRI. It's very confusing when you talk to people. But it's called Medical Research Insights. It's really an analytical application where we built this so you can start with very large patient cohorts, you know, with specific timelines. So, I mean, this is some of the things that when we showed it to oncologists, they were incredibly impressed because you can actually, it builds a timeline, you know, when the patient came in, what kind of treatments, what were the results, so you can, it was displayed graphically in a beautiful timeline. And basically for them, you know, we cut it down from, you know, months to actually days in terms of research to put these cohorts together. So the Medical Research Insights application takes all of the data. It's an analytical application that takes genomic data, it takes, you know, clinical data, it takes even lifestyle data, and you can start with a very large patient cohort and almost having conversations with the data. So the scientists absolutely love this because they go, there's no preset reports on that. It's basically, we call them key cards. So as a researcher, you can pull in any key cards that you want, and it gives you answers right away. And then, you know, you basically have conversations with the data. You go to the next thing. So you can go all the way down to a single variant in the genome of a single patient, right? So you can go up and down. So that's what they wanted. And we built this. And now the second phase of it, and they're live with the first phase, the second phase of this is to actually use this in practice. So if, you know, one of the common questions that a cancer patient actually asks when they go to their oncologist, you know, when they compare plans, you know, different treatment plans, what's the survivability, right? How, you know, what's the rates for each of these plans? And I guess it's called the Kaplan-Meier curve. I mean, are you familiar with the Kaplan-Meier curve? And typically, it's typically not used in a clinical setting because of how long it takes to compute a Kaplan-Meier curve. With this system, you can actually do it in seconds, and you can actually have a discussion with the patient discussing different treatment plans and what is the survivability of each of those treatment plans. So that phase is actually being prototyped. They're not actually live yet. Because not because of technology here, I think they're actually questioning the whole idea of showing a Kaplan-Meier curve to a patient. Is that actually right? And is that going to create a lot more confusion and so on? So that's what they're debating.
It's actually called a time to death.
Yeah.
That's probably why they don't want to share it.
Yeah. That's probably right. I think it's more of an ethical saying maybe they want to do that internally, but they don't want to share it with the patient. One more, and maybe a couple more, and then I can take questions. You know, there were a lot of questions in the previous slots. So this is, you know, a partner of ours, and we have this program internally in SAP. It's called Corporate Oncology Program for Employees. That's the code that stands for. And Molecular Health is a company that's based in Heidelberg as well in Germany. And what they've done is they've basically taken all of the publications, almost 23 million publications for the last 20 or 30 years in cancer research, and I've converted those, you know, data into a structured format, right? They call it an onco engine, which is basically, you know, their goal is that, so for example, in our case, in SAP, if an employee, you know, unfortunately, you know, is diagnosed with cancer, they have this service where they can actually send their biopsy to one of these accredited labs, and once they do the biopsy, they can run it against the molecular health, you know, onco engine, which runs on HANA, which all of the computation runs on HANA, basically to guide the oncologist on what the best three or four treatment plans are based on that specific biopsy, specific molecular test. So it basically gives the oncologist, you know, three or four best treatment plans. Right? So that's, you know, we use it in SAP internally. We offer that as a benefit to all of our employees. This one is I put this in just to sort of talk a little bit about, you know, it's not just all clinical, it's also related to supply chain. I think one of the biggest trends that we're seeing now in provider space is really the combination of business data and clinical data. And not only to reduce costs in the system, but also to improve patient outcomes, right? In the case of Mercy, Mercy's sixth or seventh largest Catholic hospital system in the United States. They serve about four states. I think they're based in Missouri, Arkansas, Oklahoma, one of the state. I don't think it's Texas, it's one of their state. So they have, you know, probably they treat about 1 million patients annually. There are about 40,000 people that are employees of Mercy Health. They have about 2,000 physicians, about 35 hospitals, you know, 700 outpatient clinics. But one of the biggest costs, and probably Patrick would know this, is the surgical unit. Within the surgical unit, it's the perioperative cost, right? And within perioperative, it's really surgical supplies. So when they did the analysis, you know, they basically understood that there are certain variability by physician, by location in terms of, you know, the cost and the for the same procedure. But they were not able to figure out exactly what was actually causing the variability, until they put all of the clinical data and business data into one system and, you know, gave data scientists an access to it so they can have actually conversations with this data. And they found, you know, simple things like bone cement that they use for knee surgeries, there was no consistent protocol on how much bone cement that a surgery needs. And apparently I was told this bone cement is not cheap, right? It probably costs a lot of money. So they were able to save a lot of money in their system. And they also have targeted two other disease states. One is breast cancer, one is diabetes within their system, where the next phase of analysis is to combine clinical data and business data to do, you know, not only find where the cost savings could be, but also to improve patient outcomes. With that, I think I have one more, but, you know, I'm going to stop because I want to take a few questions. It's only about 2 minutes. So, any questions?
Questions. Get back here. How do you, as you look to the future, now, how do you prioritize your data analytic solutions among patients, providers, and purchasers? Mm-hmm. You're going to serve all three.
I think we are, right, at this point. I mean, I think we actually serve all three. We don't have a direct-to-consumer model. We don't sell anything directly to the patients. But definitely the provider market and the payer market, SAP works with a lot of these companies to actually identify specific things that they're looking for. Well, you know, one of the things that a lot of providers are asking SAP to build is a way to actually create calculations for measuring outcomes, right? Obviously, there is, you know, part process problem, part technology problem. I mean, Mercy is a great example of that, right? I mean, they not only have, you know, CMS patients, but they also have corporate, you know, entities that contract with them. For example, Boeing. Boeing has very specific things that they want to measure in terms of outcomes. So it's, I kind of view this as a giant calculator, right? I mean, you get so many measures, HEDIS measures, so many other, you know, measures that, you know, they collect. And how do I actually put all these things together and compute all this in a meaningful manner? So I think that's one of the applications a lot of the providers are demanding. Some of them have actually built, you know, spent a lot of years building these things. But yeah, I mean, that's, you know, the way that we're looking at the market is a lot of the risk is now being transferred from the payers to the providers. Right? As we start looking at these new laws and macro NIPS laws, you know, the providers are going to bear most of the risk, especially in areas of, you know, like immuno-oncology, immunotherapy. I mean, the cost of treatment is not cheap, right? It's about $150,000 to $200,000 per patient per year. So you better be sure that, you know, the outcomes are going to be good, right? So I think those are, you know, some of the things that we're working on right now with a host of, I mean, we have a consortium. It's called the HANA Epic Consortium. There's about 45 members of that consortium, kind of the who's who in the U.S., you know, provider market. And, you know, they, you know, usually bring a lot of these use cases to us as well. Yeah. Any other questions?